Everybody loves bureaucracy. Government is hard to understand, and without understanding the systems behind it, you might be a little confused. For instance, in America, we have federal courts, state courts, we have the Supreme Court. There's a lot of different terms that you need to know. Ancient Chinese believers understood that the spiritual world has an equivalent to the physical world. So they actually had a spiritual form of the government system. One of the most important government officials that they had in the city was the magistrate. And they have a spiritual equivalent, which we refer to as a city god. And there are many, many different city gods. And one of the questions that comes to a Westerner's mind when they think about Taiwanese folk religion is, why so many gods? How can somebody just become a god? In ancient times, when somebody who contributed greatly to a city or to a place in the area died, they would often become venerated. And if what they'd done was a large enough contribution, they might actually become the city god of that area. That role was sort of the spiritual equivalent of a magistrate. City gods have been around for thousands of years. The role of a city god was very important in maintaining different aspects of life in the ancient world. For instance, they might pray to the city god for rain, or they would use the city god as the spiritual equivalent of taking care of the walls and the outside of the city. Because there may not be a physical attack, but maybe there'd be something like a plague or what they saw as a spiritual problem. And the city god had his own army and his own way of taking care of it. One of the most important aspects of the city god was that if people were fighting in a town, they could actually come before him and they could resolve a dispute. Anyone could become a city god, and in the Ming Dynasty, it became very important to have city gods everywhere. So they started to spread and to grow. And in Taiwan today, you can find about 90 temples that have a city god. Some of them are very famous, and the god itself will become more powerful or well known if he has a big city. The way a city god is created is a spiritual medium will hear that somebody who has passed away will be given that role, basically promoted.
So effective immediately, I am promoting you from assistant to the regional manager to assistant regional manager.
And this creates a little bit of an issue where maybe a city actually already has a city god. So in that case, the new promotion will have the new person become that city god, and the old god will be assumed to have been promoted and gone to a different place, or sometimes demoted, because the city god is a fallible deity. It's not a perfect deity. And if they actually weren't doing a very good job in ancient times, they would take it out into the middle of town square and whip the idol that represented it. And there's a lot of humanity attached to that. Perhaps one of the biggest roles that the city god has, though, is judging whether or not people have done good or evil, and then also judging whether they will go to this hell or that heaven, which might sound a little confusing to Westerners, but there's many layers of hell in Chinese theology. Some of the helpers of the city god are two famous generals who died tragic deaths. There's one who's a really tall guy who hung himself after he failed to help his friend who was drowning. There's also two gods that represent the people who take care of the book of life and the book of death, and they have this magical abacus. And for those who don't know what an abacus is, it's like a Chinese calculator. It's lots of abacus competitions over here. It's real exciting stuff. They take the abacus and they basically calculate, oh, are your deeds really good or are your deeds really bad? And depending on the results of that, there will be judgment given.
She's just trying to help her father.
But if she's discovered, Baju will be forever shamed. Dishonor will come to the family.
It's very similar to a lot of other world religions we have. So the Egyptians actually did this with what they call the negative confession, where they thought, oh, if you're good outweighs your bad, or you didn't commit these different crimes, you'd be allowed into eternity. Theirs was actually a little bit less about the good outweighing the bad. It was more whether or not you committed bad. But you see this pattern of, if you're good enough, you'll be forgiven. And if you're bad enough, you're gonna have to pay for it. And then we have my two favorite Chinese helpers in the pantheon, Oxhead and Horseface, which in Chinese translates to Oxhead and Horseface. And they're pretty easy to pick out of a crowd because they have an ox head and you can guess the rest. Oh. So with the city god, the role that it plays in society is this very personal representation where people can go to it and they can resolve conflicts, and if there's problems in the area, that they'd be able to get a neutral party. And as a neutral party, he's able to say, hey, you've done good and you've done bad. And it was very important in society to have that spiritual version of what they have as a physical version. And one thing you'll see a lot is almost what they say, as above, so below. A lot of times if there's a physical representation of something, there'll be a spiritual representation of it as well.
This is as above, so below. It means that what is within me is outside of me. As it is on earth, so it is in heaven. Basically, as I believe the world to be, so it is.
I'm not following.
And Taiwanese folk religion is full of that. Compare and contrast time! Woo! So Christians believe in monotheism, and that basically means that we believe in one God, one deity, and that's what we worship. And this is very different from what you're gonna find in Eastern religion. The primary God of Christianity sent his son, and we believe that it's one God, but with different personalities or representations. So his son is also God. And the son, Jesus Christ, lived a sinless life, and he ascended and became the representative for humanity, our mediator. One of the things that's interesting about the role of the city god is that it's actually very similar. Now, the city god in Taiwanese folk religion is fallible, but Jesus in Christianity is considered infallible. He's never sinned. And one of the things that we believe is that when he was put to death on a cross, that he actually rose again. So when we look at the God of the universe, or Jesus Christ, we're looking at a supreme being that deserves all of our worship and all of our affection, because there's no others. We actually see him as actually separate from creation. So many religions believe that gods are within creation, gods are created, but Christianity would say that God is outside of creation. So it really changes the value system that you put on the gods, because in some religions you can maybe like this god or that god. This god is more powerful, this god is less powerful. But in Christianity we have one god, but he's supremely powerful. Because Christianity has one god, the things that we believe about Christianity are very universal. You don't have to pick a god or go to a bunch of different gods for a solution. You can go to the same god to have a relationship, to talk to them, to pray to them, to build that faith with. And this is a big difference between Taiwanese religion. So we have a city god, and we have Jesus Christ. And one of the things that they have in common is the idea of helping people to be forgiven of their sins, or to show kind of where they go. So the supremacy and the power of having a one god in a monotheistic system is also that this god has a lot of power to change everything. So in Taiwanese folk religion, they're going to have to repeatedly come to the city god for problems and conflicts. And while Christians go to God for different things all the time in prayer, one of the biggest things we go to God for is forgiveness. But the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and the forgiveness offered is a one-time thing that lasts our entire life. And it's a pretty incredible, powerful idea of forgiveness. With the city god, you have to go year after year after year. And that's actually very similar to the roots of Christianity, Judaism, where even though you would cover the sin, it wasn't completely forgiven or atoned for. In our next video, we're gonna dive deep into the actual festival of forgiveness that we see with the city god in the city of Hsinchu, which we went and filmed, and you'll be able to see some of that. If you've been following us so far, we hope that you've also clicked that like and subscribe button. If not, it's a great time to do it. We want to continue making content about the different religious things we see in the world and about missionary life, and we hope that you'll continue to stop by pilgrimage and see what we have to offer. And how awesome would it be if your spiritual world included an equivalent of the DMV?